Welcome to the first installment of the soon-to-be award-winning series in which we answer the hard-hitting questions of the universe. What is tattooing? Should we tattoo pigs? Should I get a tattoo of a pig? So, today I'm embarking on a journey through the long history of tattooing. I've always been fascinated by tattoos, mainly because my mom won't let me get one. I hope to understand how tattooing began, how it was practiced, and what on earth the dolphin on my cousin's ankle is supposed to mean. So, for no apparent reason, I have traveled to Oxford, the home of one of the greatest centers for archaeology in the world. And, because of that, I've interviewed this professor via Zoom.
What is the cultural significance of a tramp stamp?
Well, I'm not sure people in the distant past had tramp stamps. But I suppose it is a way of expressing yourself and your identity. And maybe there's also the group expression of identity, too. But going back to the matter at hand, it was a way for them to tell stories and remember their history as a...
Right. I mean, personally, I just write important things on my hand, but I guess a tattoo would be more permanent.
I don't think they were worried about writing it down because they would forget things. It was more about having a common symbolic culture that referred to joint histories and affiliations. It was of incredible cultural significance and is a fascinating phenomenon.
Right. But was it as culturally significant as Single Ladies by Rihanna?
Yeah.
Some people say that tattoos are a form of self-expression. Others say they're just a way to avoid having to wear a name tag at parties. In the Solomon Islands, though, tattooing wasn't so permanent. It was banned by the British Empire, maybe because they really liked name tags. So, because of the high budget of this film, I spoke to a completely different expert.
Colonial authorities saw tattoos as a sign of savagery, tried to suppress their use. But in many cultures, tattoos were a symbol of status and pride.
So interesting how something that can be seen as taboo in one culture can be revered in another. It's like Vegemite, but less disgusting. Do you think there are any tattoo artists out there who specialize specifically in Vegemite tattoos, or is that a niche market that hasn't been tapped yet?
I suppose so.
Fortunately, someone else had already stolen my brilliant business venture. So I went on TripAdvisor to find an expert to find out more.
So who donates all the skin you practice on?
Well, usually for practice, we'll either use synthetic skin or as a stand-in, we'll use pig skin, which is very similar to human skin.
Do you moisturize the skin first? Like, do you use the nice stuff, like Elizabeth Arden cream?
Well, we're not necessarily using shampoo, but we do try to make sure it's moisturized so that it has the same consistency and thickness as human skin.
Ah, so it's like a spa day for pigs. What tattoo do pigs usually like to get? Do they get pictures of mud or celebrities like Peppa Pig?
Usually it's from skin from pigs that have been slaughtered.
On that disturbing note, I decided we need to find out more. I looked on Wikipedia, which is how we know so much about tattoo culture. But the reason Wikipedia knows so much is because of experiments like the one I decided to do. Not because I'm a fan of tattoo needles or because I like moisturizing dead pigs, but because I'm contractually obliged to get a good grade in this class. We decided to do an experiment using obsidian blades, because obsidian is a good way to get an edge on the competition. More from Teresa and Ian back at the studio.
Under Professor Fram's instruction, we are making our own obsidian needles together. Since the needles are highly polished and sharp to be used as piercing tools, we directly use pressure flaking technique to retouch the obsidian flakes so that we can save more time for further analysis. The goal is to identify some characteristic use wear signs of obsidian needles used as tattoo tools. So we need to document their look microscopically before and after using them. We choose to tattoo on pig skin because that is technically illegal for us as unlicensed tattoo enthusiasts to tattoo each other. And pig skin is the best substitute for human skin given their shared structure similarity. For the tattoo pigment, we got the generous support from our TF Michael and simply adopting ochre because of its ubiquity in the Solomon Islands. We use two types of mices in tattooing, following the experimental procedure from Professor Torrance's research. on the use of obsidian flakes for tattooing in Lapita, Solomon Islands. The first is piercing skin with a tip that has been dipped into the ochre and water solution. And the second one is just simply piercing the skin on which ochre has been rubbed.
Our points didn't hold up well during use. The skin was very dry and hard to pierce, while our needles were irregular because of our inexperience. After 200 pokes each, only 3 flakes were still usable, while 6 were too blunt to do more piercing. We also broke 5 needles, 2 from the dip and poke sample, and 3 from the rub and poke. 60% of breakage occurred during the first 50 pokes. Overall, dip and poke samples broke 29% of the time and blunted 0.18mm on average, while rub and poke samples broke 43% of the time and blunted 0.3mm on average. While results are limited by sample size, we did determine that the dip and poke method results in less blunting and fewer incidents of breakage. But needle quality mattered a lot. Thinner tips pierced better but broke more often, and poking the skin tired us out very quickly. Our biggest takeaway is that tattoo needles are particularly fine points which probably needed a dedicated artisan to make and a specialized artist who could control penetration depth with more precision than us.